The battle for the main waterway of Ukraine that involved about 4 million Ukrainians from both sides is considered to be one of the most large-scale and the bloodiest military operations in world history. Having liberated Donbass at the end of the summer of 1943, Soviet troops attacked the armed forces of Nazi Germany several times at the front line from Cherkasy to Poltava and reached the banks of the Dnipro River. The front line stretched for more than 700 kilometers along the shores of the river. The number of perished amount to more than 2 million. The Battle of the Dnipro was the so-called turning point in the history of the German-Soviet war. The Dnipro River was truly a major natural obstacle. In some places, the width of the river was 3 kilometers, so crossing the river was a very difficult task. It is also interesting to note that there were no such major natural obstacles further on the right bank Ukraine. So the Soviet command planned to force a crossing of the Dnipro as soon as possible and move further onto the west. Having defeated the German army in the Battle of Kursk, that ended with the expulsion of the German troops from Kharkiv on August 23, 1943, the Soviet army began a full-scale offensive on the territory of Ukraine. During September 1943, the Soviet troops liberated Sumy, Chernihiv and Poltava regions and the left bank area of Kyiv region. In 1943, the roles of the warring armies were reversed, while in 1941 to 1942, the main credo of Stalin was to hold on to the territories at any cost. In 1943, Adolf Hitler appealed to his soldiers to hold on to the Soviet territories at any cost. Defeats of the German troops induced Hitler to pay a visit to Ukraine and hold a meeting with his generals of the Werwolf headquarters that was located in the area of Vinnytsia. Ukrainian territories were a top priority for Hitler. During the Second World War, Hitler constantly visited Ukraine. In 1941, he paid a visit to Mariupol and Mykolaiv, and in 1942, he visited Poltava once and Zaporizhia three times. When he visited Ukraine for the last time in October of 1943, he held a meeting with generals. They asked Hitler to send reinforcements to Ukraine, but the Nazi leader denied their request, because at that time the Germans were facing serious problems on all the fronts in Europe and Africa. Both armies were very exhausted as a result of the Battle of Kursk, in particular the summer military campaign. But their military reserves were unequal. It was more difficult for the Germans to reinforce their army than it was for the Red Army. In particular, we may speak about support of the allies of the Soviet Union. According to Western historians, the Red Army had practically a five-fold advantage in military equipment and a two-fold advantage in terms of human resources, thanks to the land-lease deliveries from the US. So this period was very critical for the German army. Military commander Erich von Manstein and von Kluge, who led the center group of armies, understood this perfectly well, and they reported this to Hitler. They told him that it was necessary to shorten the line of defense. They said that the fight to maintain control of the Dnipro River was the most important tactic. In short, they needed to regroup and organize a new line of defense. In his turn, Hitler did not accept any of these arguments and ordered to devise a plan for stabilizing the situation. The Soviet command also understood the critical situation of the German army, which is precisely why it mobilized its troops forward to the west. They understood even if they force a crossing over the Dnipro River and seize small bridgeheads, this would put pressure on German troops, and the Germans would then understand that it would be more difficult for them to hold the fort on the western bank of the Dnipro. The Battle of the Dnipro started with the seizure of the city of Zaporizhia. For the first time in the history of the Second World War, the assault of the city was carried out by large groups of military troops. The fierce battles on the so-called Zaporizhian bridgehead, which was 20 kilometers wide and 40 kilometers in length along the front line, began from October 10, 1943. The bridgehead was stormed by the troops of several armies of the Southwest Front. On October 14, 1943, Zaporizhia was liberated from German troops. The successful military operation significantly improved the situation on the southern wing of the Soviet-German front, and due to a rapid offensive, the Red Army saved the Dnipro hydroelectric station from destruction. An offensive was already out of control, and the Germans consistently retreated. They waged the war following manual instructions and were forced to retreat from Zaporizhia in a similar way. When they were on the right bank of the Dnipro River, they blew up the dam of the Dnipro hydroelectric station, which was rebuilt by them during the war period. It is interesting that the dam was filled with nearly 200 tons of explosives, but the Germans blew up only a small section of the dam and the road surface. When liberating Zaporizhia from the Nazis, the Soviet troops breached the enemy's defense on the Molochna River and blocked the 200,000-strong 17th German Army in Crimea. Many of the commanders of the Soviet Army were awarded the revered order of Bohdan Khmelnytsky, established in October 1943, for execution of the successful military operation. The second stage of the Battle of Dnipro was the Dnipropetrovsk Offensive on October 23rd. The German forces put up strong resistance. Dnipropetrovsk, present-day Dnipro, was a huge industrial and metallurgical center. Naturally, the German side understood this very well. Further beyond Dnipropetrovsk, there are the Krivorizhsky iron ore basin and Nikopol, which needed to be maintained in order that the German army would be able to function for a certain period of time. Having seized two small bridgeheads on the right bank of the Dnipro in the area of Dnipropetrovsk, the Soviet troops forced a crossing over the Dnipro River, penetrated the enemy's line of defense, and united the bridgeheads. On October 25th, they liberated Dnipropetrovsk and Dnipro-Dzerzhinsk from the Nazis, but forcing of the Dnipro River near Kiev turned out to be very difficult. Performing the task assigned by Stalin's generals for a rapid offensive, troops of the Voronezh Front covered hundreds of kilometers per day. Rear forces, ammunition, and field kitchens lagged behind. When troops of the Soviet Army reached the bank of the Dnipro River, they saw a shoreline that looked like a desert. We must recall such a phenomenon as the scorched earth policy. Hitler issued a decree to completely burn a section of land extending 19 to 40 kilometers along the left bank of the Dnipro. This was done in order to the Soviet troops who would reach the Dnipro would not have any kind of material resources to be able to cross the river. The Germans evacuated the local population to later involve it in the construction of fortifications on the right bank of the river. Basically, they evacuated over 200,000 people, not taking into account families. That is, the main focus was to evacuate able-bodied people who could work for the benefit of the Third Reich. They also evacuated a massive amount of cattle and various material values. In late September 1943, troops of the Voronezh Front succeeded to capture several bridgeheads on the left bank of the Dnipro River in area of Kiev. The biggest threat for the Germans was the bridgeheads in the area of Veliki Bukrin and the village of Lutish. Then the Soviet troops decided to initiate the liberation of Kiev, exactly from the Bukrin bridgehead that was situated 80 kilometers south of the city. In order to enlarge the beachhead, the Soviet Union planned the biggest air landing operation in the German-Soviet War. At night, three regiments of paratroopers, the task of which was to strike the enemy from the rear, landed on the territory controlled by the German troops. This was done especially to clear the road for an assault. But the operation was a complete failure. Due to the poor training of flight crews, the unpreparedness, the landing forces faced significant obstacles. A regiment of the landing troops oriented in the morning towards the locale realized that they ended up not on the right bank of the Dnipro River, but on the left bank in the location of their troops. Part of the paratroopers ended up in the river. Another company of paratroopers, instead of landing in a safe area on the right bank in the Kaniv area, became an open target and easy prey for the German troops. Thank you. In September and October 1943, the main bridgehead of attack methodically grinded people in its millstone. Those who were penalized, regular troops and recently mobilized Ukrainians from the left bank joined the ranks of soldiers. Later they were called the Black Infantry, because there was no time to dress them up in uniforms and provide them with weapons. The first in the water were members of the Black Infantry. There were no means for them to cross the river. These people were simply driven into the water. They swam as hard and as far as they could, but eventually their clothes were waterlogged and they simply drowned. When the resource of criminals was exhausted, the regular army had already gone. Ukrainians who lived on the left bank of the river during the rapid onslaught of the Soviet army became the human resource needed for the army. But the Soviet command system was cruel, and people who were not properly trained were simply thrown into hell. This was not supposed to happen in this way. The losses of Ukrainians were extraordinarily high. Unfortunately, to this very day, the exact number of fatalities remains unknown. Perhaps some figures will be revealed in the future. Long-lasting and bloody battles in the Bukharin region practically did not yield any results. Realizing that the offensive against the Bukharin bridgehead was an exercise in futility, the headquarters of the Supreme Commander-in-Chief sent the directives to the front. It was not reported that the direction of the offensive was erroneous, and among other things it was said that the failure on this bridgehead was due to the fact that the conditions of the area were not taken into account on time. They allegedly prevented the offensive actions of troops, especially the tank army, ordering the regrouping of troops on the Lutish bridgehead. The 3rd Guard Tank Army by that time was just crossing the Dnipro River in full force. This regiment was supposed to put in place wooden mock-ups instead of tanks, simulate the work of radio stations and light a fire in order to create such disinformation and thereby convince the enemy that the army is on the Bukharin bridgehead. And then at night, it was assigned to go back across the Dnipro River, make a 200-kilometer march, cross the Desno River, cross the Dnipro River a third time in the area of Lutish Vyshgorod, and go to the Lutish bridgehead, together with the 3rd Guard Tank Army. A heavy breakthrough artillery corps, consisting of 3 artillery divisions, was to be relocated there. It was considered the most powerful armada. On November 3, 1943, the strike grouping force of the 1st Ukrainian Front at the Lutish bridgehead struck the enemy troops to the north of Kyiv. From 8 o'clock in the morning for 40 minutes, the artillery constantly fired at the enemy. It was not artillery training, but a form of artillery attack. It was a special form of artillery application. The artillery offensive from the area of Lutish and Novopetrovtsi completely decimated the advanced regiments of the Germans. The troops moved towards Kyiv and arrived in the nation's capital 3 days later. Battles on the streets of Kyiv lasted all night on November 5th to 6th, especially in the districts of the present-day Borshahivka and Siretz. The chronicle of these days is quite amazing. The whole city was in ruins and on fire. The main thoroughfare of the Ukrainian capital Hryshchatyk was also totally destroyed. Hitler, shocked by the disaster of the German troops near Kyiv, ordered to restore the position along the Dnipro River at all costs and to organize a counterattack of the German troops. Hitler's troops tried to eliminate the breakthrough using heavy-duty forces, mainly tank forces near Kyiv. These parts were transferred from France and the Bukharin and Kremenchuk bridgeheads. However, the troops of the 1st Ukrainian Front continued a powerful offensive, and the enemy was pursued in different directions towards Khorasan, Zhytomyr, Fostiv and Bila Tserkva. The largest military strategic operation of World War II for the siege of the Dnipro River lasted 4 months. In the end, the German invaders were expelled from almost the entire left bank of Ukraine. However, Ukraine paid a terrible price for this victory. The lives of its soldiers, the civilian population, the destruction of industrial cities, the burning of villages and the destruction of Lebensbase, or Lebensraum, as Hitler called it in the launch of his diabolical Scorched Earth policy.